May Gavan, my dear friends, I am Melvelan Urgalan, and I am here to bring you some more Divide and Conquer version 2.0, featuring the Misty Mountains, or the Orcs of the Misty Mountains, if you want to be precise. Now, what are we doing? We are assaulting the Vale of the Anduin, or Vale of Anduin maybe only, and assaulting Rakiberg over here. Completely having forgotten about Dane's Hall at the start, but nevertheless. So, what can I tell you first? First and foremost, I will tell you that, if you may have noticed, the last week's Orcs of the Misty Mountain episode, and a few episodes before that, actually, quite a few weeks worth, were locked to 720p resolution. Now, there's a simple reason for that. Simple reason being that I moved away from using Windows Movie Maker to using a different software. However, not actually checking properly, it turned out that I was only capable of exporting and rendering to a 720 resolution. Unless I paid for a pro version, and I did not feel like doing that. Seeing as this was only a hobby, and is only a hobby, and I do not want to spend too much money on it. As of yet, anyways. And it annoyed me, so I have to bite the bullet and actually go back to using Windows Movie Maker, even though it is far less helpful and takes so much longer to actually render the movies. But if it improves the quality of the videos even a little bit, and it improves them quite a bit, I do think, then I guess I have no choice but to do such a thing. So hopefully, from the last week's Isengard campaign, you should be able to see this in 1080 resolution. And I do hope you appreciate that. So what are we doing actually? We have just completed a mine somewhere. This city is not building, so you should probably be building something. A raider camp. That sounds good. Let's build that. Let the talent, no thank you. Can you build anything? You are building roads, that is good. Retrain those, I don't know for what, but do it. So what is our plan going to be? So I am going to take Forodrain in the next turn. They will either stand up and defend it, or I will just simply take it. After that, only this region here stands left, and we will have consolidated on the western side of the Anduin River. And Framsberg will fall as well within four turns, unless they decide to strike at us, but I find that unlikely. Rakiberg will also fall in the next enter, or the next turn as well, should they choose not to rise up and assault us. Ah! Indeed, the hobbits have decided to assault us. Very well then, we will take them on. And we will probably defeat them, because even though they outnumber, even though they don't outnumber us, they have only farmhand pikemen, woodman tracker, maybe alright, and some whalesmen. And some store hunters. I do not find the hobbitons to be that dangerous, to be frank. So I am just going to assault them and try to take them out. So there's that. What else can we talk about whilst we wait? That looks... What is that picture, actually? That's a really good question. Dragons in the sky? Actually, I have no idea what that might be. Okay, so they are going to charge at us, which is actually very, very good. And they had quite a few archers, if I remember correctly. So I'm going to take you. You're going to stand right there. The Taskmasters are going to stand right behind. Chanting, of course. The goblin units are going to stand in front as such, and the generals are going to stand on either side ready to charge out, and the wargs are going to do some charging. So do that, and you actually are going to be quite interesting to use. So position yourself in such a way that you can charge their flank. Maybe there. You are to move, actually, wait a bit. Oh, I had a different unit as well. Or one more unit, rather. Okay, so you get that. You, my dear taskmasters, will go here. Everyone run, thank you very much, because we need to get in position before they happen to array themselves and charge out against us. And hopefully we should be able to do that in time. It appears as if we are going to do that indeed, so. Those are hidden, and we'll shock them when they appear. And I am currently going to just use the wargs actually as a little bit of a flanking maneuver on the whalesmen and cause them a little bit of damage. You're still moving in position, so get in position. Those woodsmen tracker are going to have the surprise of their life when the mountain oak hunters appear out of nowhere. Store sheriffs, okay. They are charging straight at us though, so that's quite interesting. Wait a little bit longer, a little bit longer. Charge out. And you charge in. Do it now. Okay, so that's going to end poorly if you stay in prolonged melee, so let's not do that. Let's instead allow our archers to fire. Now that assault there should basically win us the battle immediately on that side, so that's good. Okay, good. Now, I am recording this video on the 7th of April, 2017. And I have this week, on the, what was it, the 6th or the 5th, actually had a little bit of a discussion with the modding team or modding leader and so on, and other people who are interested in the development of Divide and Conquer. And there was some interest expressed as to a video which would illustrate all the new changes to version 2.0, i.e. you would film and show all the different differences between this version and the 1.2 version, which is currently available for everyone to play. Now, if I'm going to do that, or I was asked to do that rather, or it was suggested that I should do that, and I think it sounds like a cool idea, so I might just do that. And if that's the case, then I should take a changelog, released, it should be released, should have been released, should have had been released on Sunday the 9th of April. And if it is, I will try and illustrate the changes listed in that one. So you may just have something to look forward to this week, or the next week, depending on how much time I actually have for recording. But just so you know, that is something that may just appear in the near future. And it may just be quite an interesting thing to see. And especially if you're like me, I do love reading a changelog and see, oh, that's changed, okay, they fixed that bug, okay, that changed that, and so on. But if you're like me, then you like reading them, and you like to know what's changed. That's alright, and everything is fine. But you may just have a little bit of a hard time getting to absorb all the different things, because you're like, you're reading it, and you're reading so many things one after another, that is very, very easy to forget about what's happened or what's changed when you actually get into the game. Which is why visual aid is usually quite helpful, because for one, it means it takes a little bit longer to get through a specific change or specific thing, and will just help cement that change into your mind, shall we say, and it helps you remember basically what the change was. And I think that's a really good idea, and therefore I think it's a cool thing, and I like the suggestion brought up by Silver Elite, currently named something in the form of Julius Caesar, whatever, for some god knows why reason. And I think it's a cool idea. And you may just have to look forward to that for this week or next week. But just so you know, that is something which is planned. And I should, now having actually said that I may do that, I think it's something I will have to do, or I'm going to just appear stupid or foolish or something. So, yeah. Which is why you should probably never promise anything before you're actually certain that you will be able to deliver on the promise. But we shall see. We shall see. Actually, you keep fighting there. We have won the battle already. Can't you give up? Or do I need to kill so that many more units of you? Of yours? I've basically not been paying attention. I've only lost 10%. I have lost quite a few mountain ore counters though, and that's really unfortunate because I do love that unit. It's so strong on the offense. Okay, now, that's good. Charge away. Or run away, rather. Wait for them to charge us again. We have actually someone in our ranks there causing some havoc. Store hunters. Missile units facing our orc bodyguards. That's not going to end well for them. We shot away all our arrows. We still have a few javelins left to throw. And yeah, they've decided to rout. Well, not rout, but break. I just want them to give up. So what I'm going to do is I'm basically just going to move there, like that. They're going to start marching in whatever way they want to, and we're going to take the city one way or another. You move away, you've done all you can. I really should be paying more attention to those wargs if I am going to use them, because they are really, really strong on the offensive, but you need to keep charging them in and out of combat or they are just going to die. And there's nothing for that. Those are going to die. Actually, you charge the store hunters and they have routed indeed. The woodman trackers have... Yeah, they have been swarmed upon. It's basically just, who has got the more units? I do, therefore I have an advantage. Who has the better units? You may have, but currently you only have dwarves. No, not dwarves, sorry, hobbits. And they are not better than my orcs, I don't think. And therefore, you're going to fall. You keep on moving. Charge into the center! Basically just a big blob of units. What's that? That's like 200, 400, 600, 700... almost 1,000 orcs just on this side charging into the center there. And they can't do anything about it either, because they're so few in numbers, and hobbits. Or farmhand pikemen. Okay, there we are. I lost 286. That's a decent number. 10% lost. That's acceptable losses. 10% is quite a few units, because I had over 2,000 units, but still. Not too bad. Also means I've captured that city. Now, it may just get a second battle immediately because I have... because if they don't rise up in the north in Vrakjaberg, they're going to take the city immediately. And I doubt they want that. For Drainisars, good. As soon as we get to rebels, we shall see what they decide to do. Okay, they are indeed charging and attacking us. Good. What do you have? You have fortunes. And I have good units. So I'm going to save the save the game, and I'm going to fight the battle. And you get two battles really quick in quick succession again. Now, as opposed to some other campaigns, apparently the Misty Mountains are quite heavily starting off with battles. At least if you push into the eastern parts of Anduin. Which is something I think you should do. Because if you don't do that, then you allow the Anduin River to build up. And if you allow them to build up, you're never going to take them because they have so much better units than you. So I think it is actually a very good stratagem to charge them as quickly as possible. Spearman stands first. You stand on one flank, you stand on second flank, and general goes in behind. And let's just speed it up a little bit, because we're just going to get in position, and I don't want them to run. Because they're going to tire. And even though we outnumber them, we may just not... Oh, actually, they have ranged units, don't they? Oh, no. If they decide to just stand there and pepper us, I'm not going to be happy about it. But not much I can do about that. Here they come. Okay, from the gloom. Fourth archers are moving into really stupid position as opposed to my mountain owl counters there. Fourth archers there, fourth spearmen, and fourth spearmen. That's really interesting that the fourth archers would move that close. But I shan't complain if they want to throw their lives away in such a fashion. Those fourth axemen are charging right at my mountain owl counters, almost as if they knew where they are. Which I think they do, so I might as well just charge them. Orc drought. Move forward. Now the fourth axemen are going to cause quite a bit of damage, so we need to aid them. So that our mountain or counters aren't completely decimated. I thought I told you to move forward. Maybe I didn't. Now again, our advantage is in numbers, and therefore we need to use that. And swarm every single enemy unit that we can, or that they put forward, because otherwise we lose our advantage, of course. Which is nice, because most, if not all, of our units are indeed larger than theirs. So we have the numbers advantage immediately, even in a one-on-one unit encounter. And apparently it did not take much to break these fourth units, because those units are already routing. Those are still fighting, and those are still fighting, though only just. And I can stop that quite quickly by doing that, yeah. And then only those units are still fighting, and now they're broken too. Quite a good victory, I must say. Who's still fighting, though? I should probably be paying more attention and not just charging ahead headlong against their units over there. We need to put more units on it. They have decided to regroup around here for some reason. I don't know why. There you go, their general has fallen. Or captain, rather. And here comes our general. There you are. End of battle. 84 units lost. That's an easy victory. 4 units, what can they do? Not much. Not much at all. Now, if I remember correctly as well, and then in this one, the fourth archers, or fourth units overall, have been weakened, so to say, because they are much, much less readily available, and you get them much, much more sparingly. Because they are supposed to only be a little bit of a small addition to add a little bit of variety and not your main backbone. And I think that's a decent change. They were a bit too readily available in the 1.2 version. So I think that's a fine change. You're building. You are not, actually. So let's get the mining network. Yes, yes, yes. Dig deeply and greedily, because what could possibly go wrong? Especially when you dig in the mines of Moria. Right? Nothing could possibly go wrong. We need views. We need to see what our enemy is doing so we can count them before they manage to do anything. That's this capital, yeah. Framsburg has not yet fallen. It's going to take a few turns before they decide to do so. Or decide to surrender, if they do surrender. So I'm just going to move a few units there. Get the slave pit, that's a good building. Brackeberg is ours. Can't build anything there. Hunting hut, yeah, let's get that when we can. And please grow, oh, look at that. It's going to take ages before they level up. Because we are growing with 1%. 1% of that is 2.5 people. So we're going to get 2.5 population per turn. It's going to take for ages before they manage to actually grow. Where's the diplomat? Where was I going? Enidweith? Probably. Where should I go? There's probably a city around there somewhere. So, what else? Not much else to say, actually, because I don't know what to do. Let's just end the turn. There's not much to do except for waiting a little bit more. building up a little bit more of an infrastructure. Bioring shield bearers. And a contingent of quite weak troops. I'm not saying I have the strongest units, but yeah, okay, let's find it. It may be an interesting one. I think I can do it. Now they're attacking us from the south, which means if we are positioned in the center, they are going to come from the front, and they are the weaker army. So it's not a bad idea to just charge them head on and take them out as quickly as possible. Oh, it's a bridge battle. That's actually very bad for them, because the weak army is going to come from there. In fact, it's very tempting to run across, take out the weak-ish army on that side, and then stand on that side of the river, stopping their units from coming across. And I think that's what I'm going to do. Because they are going to come from there, so... What I am going to do... You and the general are going to march ahead first. And potentially fight on the bridge. What else can I do, actually? Well, you are going to move in second. Start moving. Now, it's going to be a bridge fight, of course, but we have stronger units on the bridge. And we should be able to win, and then we should be able to push that side of the bridge before they manage to get to us. And if we do, we can set up a defensive position on that side, which is going to be huge. Because it means like something like this. Something like that. And our units are just going to fight in the middle, and hopefully we shall break through them before they manage to... Before that army managed to hit us in the rear. That's the hope anyways, and it should work. Hopefully. And if I manage to position my archers there, we can fire straight at this one. Come on. They started firing at us, that's fine. We are just going to push straight across the... Oh, look at that. Woodman warrior. That should be fine, though. We have strong units. And they are... Ooh, who died? Don't tell me it was my general. Come on, come down. Quicker. Come on, who died? Enemy general. Good. Meaning they are going to waver and run away quickly. Good. That means we can safely move our general across. You will move across. And you will move across. And then you two will also come. They seem to still be fighting, however. I don't know with what, because they are all routing. And we are moving across the bridge now, and since they attacked us, they are going to have to face us across the bridge. We have lost many an orc just to arrow fire, but that is worth it because we have taken the other side of the bridge. And they are going to have to pay dearly to cross it. Are you moving there? No, you're not. No, you are. And they are just going to run away, hopefully. If not, our general and mountain orc hunters are going to fight them at the backside of our army, but that's going to be fine. We have taken this side, and it's ours. With 12% losses, and quite a few of that is probably due to their archer fire as well, so... We are going to take a revenge. Come on. Here you are. Good. Revenge them. These my orcs, that is. And for some unknown reason, their longbowmen are moving first. Ah, they can fire across. There's not much we can do about it. We're going to have to endure it. Oh well. They don't have that many units. I think they had 4 unit cards. And if they're going to cross the river, they are going to lose so many to our archer fire. Actually, be on automatic fire as soon as they get in range. Which they have now. So let's have a look. How does the firing work? They should be firing straight at them, so that should be fine. And loads of damage, and indeed they are firing straight. And someone probably fell. Here they come. I thought I told you to be in that type of formation. And we shall just fall upon them. And since they have to fight in such a congested area, we should have a massive advantage. Even though they have stronger units, we have the choke point. And we can fire at them whilst they are crossing the bridge as well. Fire at those instead, actually. And fire fire arrows, why the hell not? Because you have so many arrows, and it's going to take so long for them to cross. And it's much more likely that you will kill them if you use fire arrows. Because they are heavily armored, and I don't think... And they all seem to have shields as well, so it will be hard to kill them with archer fire. Look at that torrent of fire. Hmm. No one fell. Useless. Orcs. Only way they win is through sheer numbers. There, some fell to fire. That's something. They fire slowly. And that may be a detriment. But hopefully not. My general is charging straight against their Bjorning shield bears. Are they armor piercing? They are not. That's good. Yeah, keep firing on them. That's fine. Now we need more units to move forward, ready to assist should the shield formation here fall. Go away from fire arrows and keep firing.
Only half the enemy force remains.
Now, these shield bearers, as you can see, they are not that aggressive, but they are really defensive, so they're going to take a long time to kill. Which is why this defensive formation here is quite an important thing, because it allows them to come much slower at us, allowing us more time to stun lock them and keep them in place, making it much more likely that we will eventually kill them. But it is going to be a slow thing, and they are going to take so many of us with us. But just imagine, had we stayed on that side of the river and faced them, how many had we not lost in that case?
They have lost half their
No, it won't charge you in, because you're going to die by the thousands in that. Because you have no armor, basically, that's the reason. Okay. You need to move away so I don't lose you. Who died? Don't tell me it was mine. Don't tell me it was mine. No, it was my general. Oh, come on. Don't surrender just because the general died. Keep fighting. You can kill them. 80% are already dead. Keep fighting. Send everyone in.
The battle is very much in our favor.
Did I say I don't kill generals? Well, you have obviously not been watching my Shogun 2 videos. I lose generals left, right, and center there much faster than I can acquire them. And that's bad, obviously. Look at the carnage over there. Now, if my units stand their ground, even though I lost my general, and even though the morale shock is huge, I will win, because they have lost so many percentages. Come on, don't surrender, don't give in, keep fighting, orcs. I know that you escape as soon as you get a whiff of death to your commanders, but don't give in. Unit routes, not much I can do about that. Okay. So let's fight them one at a time. Like that one Bjorning Shieldbearer, for instance. Or those three Bjorning Shieldbearers. As long as these three units are alive, at least the Mountain Orc Hunters, as long as they are alive, it should be fine. But the Carnage, oh my god. Had we not lost our general there when we did, my units would have been much, much more willing to stand their ground and much, much more likely to win the battle. I have a feeling that we may still win, but we lost so many more men just because I thought that it was a good idea to include our general in the fight. Never include your general in the fight unless you have to, at least not against units that are strong against armor. But those units should die. Indeed they did. And they are going to attack us. And that is their captain or general. One or the other. Move in position. And charge. We need to flank them. Like that. And that should kill them. Indeed it did. Capture everyone. Cool skull on their head. Oh god. Ooh, that was harrowing. Lost 66%. Phew. So, what we learned from that is that even though the Anduins are fewer than us, their units are so goddamn strong. On the good news again, we have now cemented, well, we have taken hold on the left side, and it should be a while or a little bit harder for them to get anywhere close to being back on us, or attacking us again, one or the other, however you want to say that. That's a lot of money, but we have the mountains, so we do not need it. I thought I killed everyone, apparently not. Indeed we have. That we have. Man of the hour, good. A noble death. Construction reports. So you get the mining network, more money. Okay, Methelberg. How are we doing? Get me a grain exchange, more money. We are making 9,000 a turn. Just indicating that orcs are cheap and orcs have mountain is a good combination. And they have a little bit. We are not high up in here though, so I don't think we can request an invasion on Karras Galathon. Where is it? Oh, it's removed even. It can't be attacked. Attack Celeberg. Can I get you to do that? Probably not. No, I didn't think so. Oh, well. You will get me a garrison quarter because I get the Goblin Infantry, a Goblin Band, and that's better than nothing. You move into Framsburg. Retrain that unit. Whatever good that's going to do. Can you recruit anything? No. No. Let's end the turn. Now, this is going to be the last turn, I think. Because that then it will have gone on for almost 40 minutes, and I'd like to keep them to that length. So that's quite good right there. Where did that general go? Not there. Let's build some watchtowers everywhere. That's good thing to do. And now you need to go back to Forodrain. I can get mines everywhere, can't I? More goblins, why not? Taskmasters are quite cool. I do like them. So let's get a few more units. Recruiting and building all over the place. Get that when you can. You should be able to, yeah. Okay, good. So we are just going to keep on building a few more units. And yeah, I'm going to call this one something along the lines of never underestimate the Anduin. Okay. There we are. So that should be a lesson to you all. Even though you have the numbers advantage and even though you're fighting a bridge battle and you're defending, don't count them out because they will surprise you. And they only hold this region here on the left side anymore. And if you can take that, they're going to be hard pressed to come across because you can only come across there and there and over there. So they have two positions to cross. Well, there also technically, but I don't think they will cross there because Dolguldur will hopefully keep them busy. So they're going to be hard pressed to be able to get through to this side of the bridge. This fort here would actually be much better moved over here to the left a little bit, I do think, because then you would be much, much more capable of locking down this crossing here. I think that would be a good movement, but whatever. Anyways, thank you very much for watching this episode. I think we have made wonderful progress in the wiping out of Anduin. And I do hope you are enjoying this preview into 2.0. And yeah, I will see you all in the next episode. So take care and goodbye.